And undoubtedly, we'll be talking about the pressure dairy farming is under. Unions have a significant part to play in this, not just for the dairy farmer, but we see that the skills and experience in grass production should be recognised and transferable to all grassland farming enterprises. And he juggles that magical ability of charismatic enthusiasm as a person, as an educationalist, and God love a dairy farmer. So here's Hugh McClymont.
Thank you, Johnny. I don't know if you can hear me, folks. I'll get this a bit closer. I'm a bit short leg. Thank you for those kind words there, Johnny, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. Johnny, for those kind words, you did say I was recovering. I am in a state of grief at the moment. Actually, 15 days ago, past yesterday, I had a parting with a very close friend of mine. Sally and I came to a very amicable separation. Sally was my hospital, and was there for surgery. And this is when they removed Sally. Sally was the name my wife gave my stoma, because I ended up with a colostomy bag. And I had that for 13 months, 11 days, and 5 hours. Sally and I parted company 2 weeks past last Tuesday, very amicably, and no expensive lawyer's fees were required. Anyway, so that's where I have been, folks, and what you see now is the new Hugh. I'd like to think he's a more upright and a more healthy Hugh, but anyway, we'll see. But anyway, folks, that's probably why I am still signed off, and for Robert Logan, who's here from SRUC, don't tell HR that I'm not supposed to be working, but that's another thing. Because I wanted to be here. But anyway, so folks, I'm going to talk a wee bit about grass, maximising grass production at Crichton. I am the research farm manager for my day job at Crichton, but I'll try and get this for that. Who am I here to hail from? For those of you who don't know, I nearly work out from my tongue, born and bred in Wiltonshire. Went to a wee school, that's the days I was there, called the Mule Primary. On a very clear day, I could see the Emerald Isle. I don't know where Mary is sitting now, she's still here, but yes, Mary. On a very clear day, I could look across the North Channel and I could see Northern Ireland lights. So I'm a very close proximity to the Emerald Isle lights. I moved on from there. They didn't chase me for the Mule, but I moved on from there to another education establishment of excellence called Stranraer Academy. But anyway, moving on from there, folks, there was only one journey for me, and that was to get into farming. And I then went on to WOSAC, which was then the West of Scotland Agricultural College, based at Auchincloove. We've changed their name since. We were then SAC, and now we're now called SRUC, as it says. And I don't know how this thing works for a point of whether it's SRUC, Scotland's real college. Anyway, I completed a diploma there in air in the mid to late 70s. I arrived at Crichton in 79, and if you can do the maths for that there, folks, I'm now, I had 36 complete years, I'm now in my 37th year. So if I didn't care what's going on at the Crichton now, there's not much hope for anybody else, that's for sure. I started milking cows, new managing the farm business. So that's my kind of role. But I do get off farm, and Johnny, you touched on some of those things there. I'm a local director in the Dumfries and Galloway Countryside Initiative of RET, the Royal Highland Education Trust, and there's some other RET people here who support it, a fantastic charity. I'm a former chairman of the Maize Growers Association, a crop I'm very passionate about, in the southwest of Scotland. Again, past chairman of the Southwest Scotland Grassland Society, the present chairman's in the company, but I'm still involved in the council or the committee on that. Took part of the rural leadership years ago, and as Johnny mentioned, the Farmers Weekly Dairy Farm of the Year 2013. I'm also on the committee of the 1,000 Cow Club, formerly known as the 300 Cow Club. If that gives you any indication of the size of where the dairy industry is going, but the dairy industry at the moment is going through turbulent times. I don't want to spill milk it would have been an exciting day, like folks. I know what I'm going to talk about the days, I'm going to change the price of milk, but I'm involved a bit in that, the running of that club. And I have been asked by the present company and was in times to judge the silage in 2015. I'm okay if I've been asked again today, 2016. Wow, all right, but anyway, folks, that's a wee bit of when I get involved with them, that's right. But as you can see, I'm the best, getting better with the camera. That was in 2005. And I don't know how the hell I managed to win the silage competition that year, like, but ever since I've not been allowed to take part, because everybody asked me to judge it. Like. But as you can see, Johnny Watson and I have both favoured well over those years, like, the last 11 years, like, you know. That's without the aspect of airbrushing and whatever else. Anyway, that's been my association with Watson Seeds, and yes, still enjoy that sort of relationship here. We were a bit crying, folks. Over the last 15 years, I've been managing and took the coon numbers up to 350 to 500 plus. Area land farms, about 240 hectares, whatever that is, 590 acres, 310 hectares total now, that's 750 acres. It's all rented, biggest blocks on a 25-year lease from the Scottish Government, and the remainder was SLVT, but now it's an annual lease and various ongoing discussions with local landowners here to try and maintain our land mass, and if possible, probably look at any other farm business trying to grow it, if that's at all possible. One of the things I seem to get a lot of credibility these days on is how I utilise organic manures, and also how I try and minimise my use of purchased chemical fertiliser. I do tend to now. Over the years, it's a straight order. It tends to be a lorry load of urea for the acres I give you there, and a lorry load of ammonium nitrate, and that's basically their spend on nitrogen fertiliser. More importantly, and we've heard that in the previous two speakers, the secret, and it's no bloody secret, my father, my grandfather before us could tell us all about it, but the use of lime. We need to correct our farm and keep our soils and look after our soils. So I always rather spend money now on lime and get the pHs right on the farm, if that's the best way. And I think everything else will work better then if you get the pH right. And especially your SH1T, be it solid muck or liquid muck, whatever you're doing there, these all certainly work better when you get the pH at 6 and above, if that's the best way. So folks, 510 cows split, 280 at the main stead and 230 acre head. But 330 young beasts, that's in for a heifer calf, up to 2-year-old calf, and at the moment there's about 35 bull calves. I'm rearing black and white bull calves at the moment to about 3 months old, and then there's a man taking away, giving me a cheque. Mostly I'm making a fortune, but I'm turning money, and they're going away to the northeast of England, and he's finishing them there. Like. So I'm trying to get the best I can with what livestock we've got there in terms of say the surplus stock coming out of the dairy industry, in terms of males. Which is, it's inevitable, but I suppose there's other ways now, sex semen, which we do dial a bit like. So. I, Boys Farm, Crichton, 310 hectares, lowest land, basically at sea level. There are some periods in the year when it's below sea level, and high tide, and certain times, and the highest bits are about 40 metres above. And I would say, Boys Country, you can't make a job of that, you shouldn't be at the job. Mate. But predominantly a sandy loam type soil. I was talking to somebody else earlier about NVZ, just the whole farm and all the land that we do farm and sit within an NVZ. For those of you who know what an NVZ is, I used to think it's not very sensible, but as you can see, I didn't go to school very often. The NVZ is there, it's laid upon us. It means you have to farm to dates, you have to farm to rules, and then you do get inspectors that will come along and challenge you and all your recording. But if anything else, it will make you a better farmer. But, it's a big pill to swallow. Crops with no grass, yes, we've got a bit of grass for grazing, a bit of grass for conserving. Some permanent pasture, you'll see some slides in a minute at that might get. Maize, 100 acre of maize, 80 acre of winter wheat, about 40 acre of red clover. I'm needing more. If there's only seedsmen in the house, in the room the day, I can maybe buy some red clover seed like. Spring beans, we'll probably put about 100 acre of spring beans in. And this year, probably about 40 acres of spring wheat I'm going to put in. And over the last 4 years, we've been growing lucerne. I've never heard lucerne mentioned this morning's presentations. Maybe I don't know if they do that in Northern Ireland or not.
Very little of it.
No, somebody did say it was the land of milk and honey. They have sense in Southern Ireland now. But the Crichton lack a wee bit of sense coming again. I'll show you a photograph of Lucerne. I don't think it's a crop for southwest Scotland. It's certainly not a crop for Lanarkshire, that's for sure. But anyway, again, as a research farm, I'm asked to do these different things, and you'll see that one there. But it's a nitrogen fixing crop, and it has great merits. Yes, I think if you're in the right part of the country to grow the crop. Number of folk in the farm with six permanent members. I'm semi-permanent and half the time I'm either off in hospital or I'm on the road, but never mind, but there's six men in the fort. And then I've got seven contract or part-time staff there, milking cows or feeding cows and covering the farm, because as you can imagine, it's a 365 day, 24-hour operation. And I would employ on the farm only about 11 researchers are based there full-time. That number can go up, depending on the level of research work that's going on and draft them in from various bits and fairs. So folks, me, you, there's 20 or 30 cows in milk three times a day, five circuit recorded herds in there, so a range of milk production systems, genetics, that gives you the range, I'll explain that later. Two systems of milk production. We're coming to the end of the present systems work, which has been running for 5 years, which is funded by the Scottish Government. Where we've got a group of cows, 100 cows, two levels of genetics, which I'll explain later, but the system is home-grown feed system, where we grow everything on the farm for these cows, nothing purchased at all. The only thing that's purchased there will be minerals. I'm good, I can't even make me any minerals just yet, like, but buy minerals for these cows, but the rest is grown there. So that's why we grow the range of crops that I can explain earlier there about there, to get a balanced ration. Conversely, on the other side of the shed, we've got 100 cows on a byproduct system where the only form of roughage they're being fed is wheat straw, and some of those cows, the high genetic merit cows, are delivering this over 11,000 litres of white water. Anyway, I'm not going to go any further than that at this moment in time. So, two complete systems at the main farm. An acre head tends to be commercially managed by myself, or just dictated by a research worker, if that's the case. So, what have we done now? So young stock folks either here are heifer calves and rear and bull calves, but they're here at the main unit and in sheds around the farm. And also today I've left the farm in capable hands of my team. There's a calf rear and young stock leaving on the day, and there's 50 folk in Ridge to come to that to see how to rear calves. So I hope you've seen a positive message while I've been here in Manx. 850 cubes milk three times a day there, and then we've also got a robot commissioned in September last year, milking 50 cows. And the whole farm calves all the year round to give me an even milk supply, but more importantly, give us an even supply of cows for doing research. It also allows the cows to express their normal fertility, so we're not intervening too much around some of the trial work that's going on. We sell our milk to Arla. We don't get the best price in the country. We're not getting the worst, and that's as much as I'm going to say in milk pricing at the moment, folks. I can't change it. If I could change it, I wouldn't be standing here. I can show you that. And we try and sell, that's what our aim is, in about 4.3 million litres. So those of you who can work with 500 cubes in that day, we're just a tad short of 9,000 litres. Milk sales. Yeah. Again, genetic systems project, Langhill Farm, based outside Edinburgh. Those of you centre of the universe, which is Edinburgh, as far as I'm led to believe. Sorry, Johnny, no intention meant there towards the Midlothian sector. But anyway, we have the Langhill Genetics breeding project running at Crichton now. 2002, we moved the nucleus of that Langhill herd to Crichton. This genetics breeding project is it's probably the oldest breeding project running in the world, with the Holstein Friesian Cattle Society. We've got two distinct lines of Holstein Friesians. We've got a select line, which are one of the highest genetic merit recorded herds in the UK, and we have a control group, which represents the average of the genetic merit pool within the UK. So that's running there along, and then subsequently, that's split over the two different systems that I explained earlier, the byproducts and the homegrown. HDB Dairy, as it's now called, it used to be Dairy Co, or maybe Pairs, and again, I'm not going to get into that there. They were kind enough to award a 5-year study to ourselves at Crichton. That came to an end. But there were some words came out this morning about soil compaction. We've done a lot of work in that there, and there'll be further work to be sent out to various sectors through media and whatever else on that soil compaction work. But a grazing work looking at growing grass fish from slurry. I'm going to say SH1T there, that's my language, it's ladies present. Outwintering we did last year, and looking at outwintering dairy heifers. Feeding lucerne, we're currently feeding big bale lucerne at the moment at three different levels and to groups of cows. And this was lucerne that was cut either at flower stage or bud stage. And the one that's sort of taken kind of a bit of interest now is cut and carry. Speaking to you and Pete earlier, cut and carry is the new name for zero grazing. But anyway, it's where you cut the grass and bring it into the coos. Mary was talking about in Wooden Island there, maybe we get more sense there, they put the coos out. They're not working with the size of coo that I'm working with, like, and my coo's a lazy cow, I'd rather bring the grass into her. She does perform when you put the grass in front of it. There's many different ways to skin it back, because you're all well aware of it. Malawi, aye, small country in southern Africa, sub-Saharan Africa. Huge links there between Crichton and Malawi. They've never asked me over there yet, but Afrikaans is no very good yet. I could brush up on that. Main thrust of that was to try and improve the dairy industry in Malawi. Malawi, where the average herd size in Malawi is 3 cows, and Scotland is 177 cows. The same principles apply there, irrespective there. And the, again, we've had a lot of people came over from Malawi, been educated at Crichton, and went back. Some of our colleagues within SRUC have went out from Barony and from Crichton out to Malawi. And again, I think that's been a huge international project on behalf of the organisation to try and improve a small, very poor country in southern Africa. Commercial feed and trial work, yeah, we'll do a bit of that for various companies that come knocking, and we can do feed trials that evaluate different products and such like. Greenhouse gas emissions, Cosmos project, those of you who maybe travel past Crichton, there's one field, and there's no photographs of that, I apologise for that one there. Last summer, there was a hell of a material in this field of electronic wizardry collecting data from gas, emissions from gas coming up from the soil, and afterward applied slurry and after applied fertiliser. It's in conjunction with the University of Edinburgh. They flew a drone, we saw some efforts of drone work this morning, a drone over the field at a certain height, collecting samples of the greenhouse gases, and then they brought a small aircraft in do the same thing, and it flew over the field. Again, look at this. Looking at greenhouse gas emissions from grassland for the next generation of farmers in the audience, folks. Yes, we're all going to look after the environment, and this is some of the work that's going on. This is some of the work that we as an organisation take part in. Don't blame me, I only provide the field, folks. Behaviour studies looking at dry cow stock and density, that's work that was done last year. Alerts, Robert spoke highly this morning up there in the beef industry, what you've done in the electronic EID and management that there. The dairy industry keeps going on in terms of different jewellery our cows wear. I bring a lot of wings onto Crichton through Red, and I used to tell them I dress my girls up well in jewellery. They've got ear tags, they've got necklaces, they've got ankle straps, they've got every different thing, but all that there is to download information. And that's either onto a robot or onto Parliament software, or as Robert said earlier in his presentation, onto your smartphone or your tablet. I took my tablets this morning, but I mean, there are different tablets. Anyway, electronics in this industry in agriculture, Robert made it, precision farming has got to be the way forward, and I think we're here to embrace it. We're going to have to take it on board and go forward with it. And it's fantastic the information you get out from a dairy cow, but more importantly, from looking at your whole farm business. We need to embrace it as a forward-thinking industry. Bull calf castration study, that was work we did last year for a company under licence. And for those of the males in the audience that don't know what it's like to be castrated, I've never suffered that affliction. I don't want to even go near there, folks. But those of you like me who've had male calves in the farm and to make them into a bullock, then obviously you get through the castration process. A knife is sometimes the preferred route, but now there is some thinking, and we were to look at pain control of animals when we were actually going through a castration. So we had male black and white calves. We took blood levels off them at different every 2 hours after the procedure had been done, and we were injecting them with a particular product, and they were measuring cortisone levels to measure the pain control. Now, I don't know how many in the audience, the practical farmers in the audience, are actually involved with cutting calves, but yes, you will always see it 2 or 3 days later after the incident has happened. They can hang back for a day or two. It must be quite painful. It's kind of nasty. Anyway, so who knows where that's going, folks, but that's some of the kind of work that's been going on in the cow health project, the robotic system, which I'll talk about in a minute. And what I'm about to start this spring, DEFRA, and working with DEFRA here, a low protein feeding study to 50 cows. Homegrown feed system, high genetic merit cows are being more than that now, they're being over 8,000 litres. The average are being just about, just a tad short of 7,000 litres. So that's the difference genetic brings on a system like. The byproducts feed system I mentioned earlier, again, it's over 11,000 litres. The controls, again, you see this, it's very similar runs in here, the differences of what genetics will bring on the same feeding system there. Like. There's the shed at Crichton, okay, it's a fairly old photograph, 2012. That's the byproduct system down there with the straw, it's the main form of roughage, and these are the homegrown cows there. 100 cows there, equally split between control and select genetics. And these feed bins here, where we measure intakes of feed and water for 3 days, and then they swap to behind the straps, and then the ones behind the strap go behind the bins, so we can alternate. So we get a phenomenal amount of data from these cows in terms of intake and water intake. We milk them 3 times a day, so they're automatically recorded. They're automatically weighed when they exit the parlour. They go over another piece of kit that measures their actually walking gait. So again, that actually tells us again whether early incidents of lameness. At midnight every night, that information is all gathered together in a zip file and it's sent automatically to our database in Edinburgh. So there's a hell of a lot of data gathered on Crichton on a daily basis. That was on Sunday. I took a walk. I took for part of my therapy. I'm how do you do it? The dog a walk, or the dog touched me for a walk. But the dog got a bloody feed of this stuff and we seek that night, but never mind. This is what we feed our cows. This is the ration presented. These cows, just for the dairy men amongst you, these cows have never been outside their house 365 days a year. And they're fed 6.5 kilos of straw, and I'll show you the ration in a minute. And the straw has been through a mill process. So you don't need grass to feed cows. You didn't want to hear that, John Watson, right? But anyway, but there are alternatives. Thinking behind that system, folks, is what we talked about today about land and the availability of land and how we manage our land. We stopped making land a long time ago, and the demands on our productive, fertile lands in this country increase every year. The Scottish Government's thinking was, could we produce food on the back of other industries? So everything that's going into those cows is a byproduct, and that will allow us then to use our land for other uses. Now, not for everybody, but it can do, so it's basically a no-land system. Unfortunately, the cows produce milk, produce a bit of SH1T. You do need land for that SH1T to be utilised to grow crops. Or alternatively, you could be looking at renewables and biogas and whatever else. The scurry could go into that, and again, that would still come back out and you could combine. So there's lots of opportunities for that system. But so it's been running now over nearly 5 years. Well, then coming down to 5 years. What we feed them, they're getting 15.5 kilos of blend, which consists of distillers, dark grains, corn flakes, biscuit meal, soya and sugar beet pulp, 2 kilos of molasses, 200 grams of minerals, 400 grams of megalac, 6.5 kilos of wheat straw, and 8 kilos of vitagold, and 10 kilos of water. A heavy influence there on the distillery byproducts. So I'm out in company, I do encourage people to drink whiskey, because it does help our industry no end. But that's costing, that there, I put that together and it's actually £4.48 a coup, but what, about 11.7p a litre, folks, it's costing me there. If you're only getting 21 pence for your litre, it doesn't leave you much. But anyway, I've seen the more than the price of that. Homegrown feed system, that was taken on Sunday again, and that's a ration there, which I'll show you in a minute. The cows look completely different. The cows were housed totally on the day after AgriScot, which was about the 18th or 19th, I think, of November. They were out from the 14th of March last year, it was when they were turned out for one window, and they were grazing right up to that, sort of mid to late November for one window. And during the height of the grazing season, we're grazing for two windows, they're always housed at night. That's
So we tend to manage that group of all year round calving cows in this homegrown feed system. When we feed them crimp wheat grown in the farm, we feed them minerals, which I hate to buy in, 200 grams of that a head. Beans, spring beans, 8 kilos, fairly damp beans this year. 2015 maybe wasn't the best year for beans, but anyway, I've got mine harvested. And half a kilo of straw, and then 41 kilos fresh oil for first cut silage, and the 6 kilos of maize silage at 30% primark. Interestingly, when you work that out there, I've worked at that figure there, at about 11.4 pence a litre. I'm costing my forages at £1.40 per tonne of dry matter, £1.40% of dry matter, for beans at £160 a tonne, and wheat at £130. There's my figures, folks. But anyway, that's where that comes from. No picture again, unfortunately I couldn't fit you in. I usually try and take a photograph of last day out, but that showed 2013, just lying in front of my summer residence for me. You can see a little kind of modern lifestyle. But that was cows just in the sort of last grazing round of 2013. I am planning an early turnout in 2016. I was doing the same in 2014. As you can see, the left hand photograph, that was taken in February, I think it was 2014. This was taken on Christmas Day, my son's Land Rover. Now you go, I says, for Christ's sake, stop, boy. I says, didn't get in there, I'm not pulling you back here, and I'm not paying for the cost of repairing it after he gets there. Anyway, this is a lake of water which seems to form every year. And again, we don't need to talk too much about climate change and the weather we've had recently. But aye, the puddle is dissipating, but I've just got a text this morning to say we had 48 millimetres last night recorded at Crichton. So I can imagine that there will have filled up again. That is a new college at Dumfries and Galloway. Aye, 3 weeks ago today, it succumbed, which I told them it would do, and they built it there, but they don't listen to me, I'm on a farmer. But anyway, it actually succumbed to a lot of flood water coming off the road and surrounding farmland, nothing to do with me, I guess. But anyway, it got some water, contaminated water at the basement of that college. But anyway, this is the things that happened in these challenging times now. But how do we keep getting cows out early and out late? It's a cow track, and that's the same photograph again, folks, but it's where the water lies when it comes to heavy rainfall. But again, this was when it was constructed, and I made it with recycled plastic from solely recycled. I laid it on top of the feet of the grass, no prep, and I just dusted it with different types of material there. We are a rented farm. My thinking was if I could put that material down, if we ever moved from your rented farm, you would take your road with your cow road with you. But interestingly, it is a cow track only. Occasionally you'll see me sneaking the pickup on it, but I mean, anybody else with a tractor on there, they will get my right tool will be somewhere where they won't like it, I can assure you. And there's one of my contractors in the audience, if I catch him on it, then he knows I'll track it. Anyway, that's how you deal with contractors, folks. But anyway. Grazing systems are crying. We talked a bit earlier about the different grazing systems. We want a rotational paddock system. Warm work this, Johnny. Yeah. I've got a big glass here.
Big glass,
yeah. It's lovely stuff, right? Yeah. Rotational paddocks, where the farm split up into 2 hectares, then we subdivide them into 1 hectare blocks. So 100 cows going out to grass, so the 100 cows get a hectare. We try and enter them in at 2,800 kilos, it says there, measured by a plate meter, and the lady was displaying her wares, whatever the lady is now. I saw what she was trying to sell. I didn't see anything about her aid kit, but never mind. Johnny said that. Anyway, we use a similar plate meter, and we'll measure twice a week during the active growing season. So we have a fairly active profile of where the grass is growing in front of you and behind you. So we'll try and go in at 2.8 and exit at 1,800, and that equates back to a ton of grass over the 24-hour period, so 10 kilos a hectare. There's 10 kilos of grass, dry matter per head. We'll get the next 10 kilos in the shed at night as we feed them in the shed. As we've done complete grazing, and with these extreme Holsteins, certainly for summer calving, we're losing half the condition, so we felt we'd be better looking after them in the shed. So we balance it up with a ration made up of maize and whatever else, which balances it, complements the grass. If the grass gets away from you, and grass is a fantastic crop, I must say that in the present company, but not always easy to manage, and it does grow, it depends on what the good Lord that puts out in front of us. And if it gets away above 3,000 kilograms or 12 centimetres in height, then I will cut that and bale it and basically take those bales off and then go in with a slurry injector and inject slurry into that there, and 3 weeks later we'll be back in operation again. But there's my kind of fertiliser. They'll fertilise every 21 days with 30 kilograms of nitrogen, 25 grams taken. The last version grown the 2nd of July. These are daily grass growth from the plate meter readings. The 14th of April, we're only doing 24 kilograms last year. But way up in early June, we're near 100 kilos to the day, 100 kilograms to try mark to the 80 in the day, and end up in September. But I would say right through the season, it's still going to go. And an interesting note on that, folks, on fertiliser, I've also got a text to say that T-sum, we were talking about T-sum earlier, when we came into the room, an old measure of when should we apply fertiliser. Well, T-sum arrived at Crichton on the 7th of February, so 10 days ago, when T-sum 200 arrived. I've not put anything on yet, but I knew there was rain coming. I didn't realise there was 48 mil coming, but anyway, who knows, I might be putting a sprinkling area on before the weekend, certainly into next week. That's how we manage our grazing paddocks. That was the second grazing round. Cows are grazed here. This is the middle fence. We drop that, leave the post here, pull the wire, then the cows go into that in there, then they're going back to the next one here. And you just keep going around your paddocks in that form of the lines. Just a kind of wee kind of snapshot of our last year's grazing at all. Anyway, we feed our grass. Miracle Grow, you can buy Miracle Grow in the garden centre, but I'll make my own. It's basically separated liquid coming off a slurry separator. I'll try and check that if I can get away with it. And basically, the first, we've been in all the grazing fields now, and then we haven't done the first pressing yet, but say it's imminent. We've gone with 30 kilograms of nitrogen, and that's in the shape of urea, and then we'll just follow on as it says there. And after mowing and bearing, we'll put in slurry and work it that way. And we'll try and graze from March to November, as I said, with the paddocks. We've got a total purchase then, 170 kilograms to the hectare, 136 units to the acre. I remember when I was a boy at Auckland Crew, and in those days we were putting on 300 units to the acre, and that's the kind of figures. It shows you how much we've put back in and fertiliser usage. One thing I will tell you about rotational grazing, that my experience, maybe not for everybody, Johnny touched on it earlier, but again, it depends where you buy your grass seed. Some of them will supply you a lot of Dawkins and thistles. But anyway, with this cutting and baling, when the grass gets away from you, and because we will probably cut our paddocks twice throughout the grazing season and bag that grass, I have never, and Peter's in the audience, people will do my spraying, they'll hardly ever spray a grass field at Crichton now for Dawkins and the grazing fields. And with that continual management of cutting and baling, we seem to have suppressed all those Dawkins and thistles that would be your biggest challenge. And it's amazing, but obviously with it under electric wire, you will see an old thistle ground there because you only got to it right now. So we can keep our swords clean mechanically with it, chemicals. So another point for the environmental issues there. But overseen in here, you question why the hell I was doing it when you see that photograph, but that field got heavily poached throughout the winter period because I was out wintering heifers in the adjacent field, and I felt sorry for them. That's a field behind my house, and decided it would be a wee bit of overseeding to try and improve it. I walked across it yesterday, and you wouldn't care. I mean, it looks as good as, well, not just as good as that there, but it's still coming out of the effects of winter, but fantastic. I was using a Pico Harrow, that works, but you'll never know. But the fact that it was germinal seeds I was putting on that day, no Watsons, I said, maybe that's probably the big difference there. Like. Anyway. No, I want to mention names here in case Johnny throws me out. Anyway, can you know if you can see that one, folks, or not? But direct drilling the grass seed. Our hosts today favour Duncan and Nature's and drills. I've tried them. I like this one here. This is a Vredo. I don't know if it's very clear, the photograph, but very close spacing of the discs. We're using the Nature's and the Duncan. You may have to do a crisscross pattern, and the bloody contractor piece charges you obviously more because he's spinning longer way. But with that in there, you can get away with one pass. And that field there was a winter wheat stubble I was putting on. That was in late August, actually, early September, for NBZ purposes. I put Italian in, and I put slurry on it, but it was a green crop. And we just did one pass over with a Vredo drill. And yes, the slurry, the crop and that Italian utilised the slurry, so that ticked the box. Slurry again this last spring, and we dropped a bag and I took grass size off that Italian on the 4th of May, and then it was back into maize under film on the 8th of May, and so turned it back round again. Anyway, I like that machine. We've done a bit of rejuvenation work on some of the other parts of the farm for another reason, is to try and titivate some old sorts of tantalum that they've got, and it seems to be, I think, my eyes are telling me it's going to be in trouble. Ah, grassy choices, so I can watch what I'm saying here, this is my slide, but anyway, I do use this product here, Durat. Best is sold me that a number of years. Johnny talked about longevity and about trials work. I think probably my longest field of Durat was about 12 years old, and it's still not shown any signs off yet, like it's still holding its own, like, so testament there. I grudged every penny when I bought them, but yeah, it's been a good investment.
And the German old team will be pleased to know that Durat's got Abergain, Abermagic, Aberchoice, all in the mixture, which are all your PPI fingers, Mary. So that's good.
Like you expected me 10 years plus. So there you go, I'm getting it. So that's it. I did resell one, and I think it was 12 years last year, and I felt it was immediate move. So I was going to try Mintil method, but there was too much starch left on it, and the spray operators and the audience out watching CT, he missed a wee bit, so they got into the flu. Anyway, it doesn't matter, we've got a fantastic VC coming on there. In fact, that was one of the ones there with the photograph of the lake. Anyway, I don't know how Durat's persistency is to be waterlogged for more than a few weeks, Johnny. But I'll tell you later as the season goes on. White clover, we'll try and put a white clover mix in amongst any of the mixtures there to try and maximise. Cotton, yes, I'm using tantalum, and again, through from Johnny, has worked really, really well. Through Andrew, anyway, Andrew Bestel telling me that there, and you'll see some of that, some of the other stuff. Again, Scottgrass 2013, the year I cancelled it. Some of those fields are still standing. I rejuvenated them at half rate in August 2015 with that radio drill, and these are looking fantastic. That is when you get your mixtures totally wrong for Watson's light, and they send you these bloody weeds light. But anyway, folks, sorry to take that one away, but I do a wee bit there, question that. But this is wildlife habitat, species rich meadow here on the left, mown grassland. Birds here, but bits of the farm where it's maybe not the most accessible, we've done a bit of that there. So no, joking aside, this is what you'll do a wee bit for the wildlife, and I get involved a wee bit with RSPB and that. And they'll come in here, bird counts, and tell me I'm a wonderful farmer, and I'll take the smile and take the credibility. Makes no bloody difference to my milk price, but again, it's back to how we manage our farms and how we manage the environment. If the bird life on the farm is increasing, then somebody's doing something right, is the best way I can say that. But folks, I do get into it, and that was before Sally. I get into the positions. That is my tie, you can see there, Mike, it's hanging there, but yes, I've come up with some new ideas. And there you go, a blue and red clover at Crichton in 2010. Fantastic crop there. That's a few out-winter heifers on just this winter. I'm actually contemplating going back in again with a mixture of red clover. Again, I'm looking for it. But it wants to give me a bag for nothing, I'll take it. Anyway, as it should be, a red clover mixture, tantalum mixture. Again, Andrew, you know the background of what's in that mixture. But did as well. And there was the kind of yields we got 2010. I think 3 years is probably it runs out of steam after that, and then you hate to think of it there. But no bag fertiliser, basically slurry. And to be honest, no too much slurry is the best way of putting it. You can see the analysis that I put up there, analysed it too much. Lucerne, that was 2005, second cut in August. You can see the kind of bulk there, and we can grow it, but it doesn't excite me. That field will definitely come out. Sorry, Ian, you know, you provided the seed, but anyway, I've had enough of it. Anyway, folks, I'm into my selfies, because I've no friends. spring beans, the variety is Babylon. We grow beans, I've been growing the last 4 years, this is the fifth year. And again, from the cap reform, you're not allowed now to grow one nitrogen fixing crop, you need another one. So I'm going to look at probably lupins is another one where we combine this crop here. Right? So, and there's the combine working there, yes. You can see it says home down right, so anyway. But that was this year. The crop averaged 2.6 tonnes to the acre, but at 66% dry matter, which is 75 moisture content, no the way it would be. Last year, in 2014, it averaged 2.6 tonnes to the acre, and that was at dry weight at 16% moisture, so a difference year on year. But we can grow beans. Beans combined off, and I think the next one showed, well, not Disney showed it, but there was one there, showed you how a prop corn, we'll drop them off the combine into a crimper, but no break them, just apply prop corn, store them whole, and then crimp them as we feed them back out. And then that's that field as it was taken in December, and that is now turned talon, because that field, went back there, yes, ploughed it, reseeded with tantalum in preparation for Scott grass this year, and as you can see, the River Nith runs, where's this point? River Nith runs along below these big pilings there, very close, low-lying ground, it's lying underwater. But it was dried up last week, 48 mil last night, but we put it back to the same similar state, but it disappears quickly. But anyway, that's fields at Crichton. Oh, there we have popcorn on the beans, I think. Slightly storage at Crichton, now we've got tanks, concrete tanks, steel tanks, concrete tanks, acre height, umbilical pipes, as you can see there. Yes, and probably not enough storage yet. But anyway, yes, where you've got milking cows, you've got milk, and you've also got SH1T. You need to be able to handle these nutrients to their maximum effect. I favour this method here, if I can get away with it, shallow injection. And again, I don't know if there's any of the I know the press are here, but they'll not print this, but anyway, it's amazing how much of that stuff you can put in the ground with an injector, and you can't even, you only record what you put in. But anyway, that's another story. It doesn't run off an injector, you can't see that. Anyway, but again, you're putting the liquid in at the roots, minimising the smell, because we're quite close to urban Dumfries, there's the college, and there's the town there. So again, these methods all try and help to dissipate the smells and live with our neighbours, if you can't do. We separate a slurry majority of it, so we'll squeeze it, don't bed with it, haven't gone that route yet, but here we're just separating it out, and solid muck will go out onto land for growing maize, it looks like, and the liquid winter towers, to make it more manageable. And that slide there, a colleague of mine who's now retired from SRUC, Adrian Jones, over the west area, did the work on that there, but I favour shallow injection there because you've got basically about 13% losses, 87% basically take up of your nutrients by putting it in there. If you start doing the lines of trailing shoe and trailing hose, you can see a bit more losses, which is to be expected as it goes to the atmosphere. But it's all about slurry and how you manage it. Again, you can't manage it if you don't measure it. If you don't know what's in your SH1T, I know what's in my slurry. I get regularly phone calls from farmers throughout Scotland. Hugh, you seem to care a bit about slurry. Yes, I talk a lot of this bullshit, but anyway, I say this. But your slurry, what you get versus you need to test it because everybody's farm is different, everybody's farming system is different, and the livestock output is different. So this is Crichton figures, folks. So raw slurry, 6.4 dry matter, 2.8 kilograms of nitrogen, 1.4 kilograms of phosphate, 3 kilograms of potash. Played through the squeezer and the dry matter goes down to be expected. The nitrogen content goes up a bit more, the phosphate's where it is, and potash will be a bit more. And the solids, as you can imagine, the dry matter goes up to about 16%, and the kilograms of nitrogen and phosphate and potash accordingly. But these are not as available. These have to break down in the soil before they can be released. The liquid, which is far more available, that's why I call it Miracle Grow, because it's readily available. Maybe what the raw study or similar in between. And that's, again, a contractor, they usually do that. Anyway, putting on in 2014 onto growing winter wheat, we had trailing shoe, dribble bar thing there, putting onto winter wheat. Right? We'll do two applications onto winter wheat. And we regularly, Robert talked about getting results there. We'll struggle pretty to get on the 4 ton, but we'll be 3.5, between 3.5 and 4 ton per acre. Of wheat, and that's only 50 kilograms of bag nitrogen, and the rest is obviously achieved with slurry, right? So trying to utilise our slurry to the maximum effect. You need to measure the fields, the man that drills it, the man that combines cuts it, because you're putting that on there, you don't follow the tram lines, you're just going to follow the width of your belt. Anyway. We talked about indices of farms and how we manage it, rightly or wrongly, I use this company, SOYL. And that's a full map done of the pH of the farm in 2011. I've just done the whole farm there a fortnight ago again. And unfortunately, I don't have the data. I'd love to have been here the data transposed that colours to where we are now. But as you can see, we're far from perfect. What fields down next to the river here, which were in the 60s, where they should be. Some fields are kind of hungry. I've addressed them now. They've had lime. I'd like to think those colours are changing. But no one telling I get the full thing coming back from SOIL. But I'll see what that my management is actually there. But it's back to how, again, once you see that there, you can act on it. And doing a W across a field, yes, better than nothing. But when you see it with that, that was our GPS map. Johnny made a comment, he said he'd sort of sampled a money acre last week, did you say?
I did 14 fields.
In a day?
In a day.
That boy came with a motorbike for the borders and did 500 acre in a day. Well, there you go. But that just shows you, he was working with a GPS map.
Yeah.
But that's the kind of technology, you understand what I'm saying. But I'm looking, I am definitely looking forward to seeing that information coming from the whole. I've had some fields back and I can see some changes there. Right? So, and again, looking at phosphate mapping of the farm. Again, some of the areas, extremities of the farm, you can see a wee bit more hungry. But these are here, are basically sitting at this high minus phosphate levels. And again, it's where probably slurry and cows have been grazing, whatever else on the farm. So again, when you see it, you can start to manage it. As I said earlier, I only bought P and K onto the farm for the last, I would say now, 14 years. Interestingly, this one here was set very high. We did then anyway with potash around the main stem, which is here. But looking at some of the individual fields, they are now starting to deplete. So maybe I'm going to have to look at now strategically applying some potash to the farm. But again, it's back on information provided. And that's yet to that information on the manager. Cut and carry. Now there's a new idea, zero grazing, whatever else. Cutting grass there, ride on lawnmower, probably a better way of looking at it, Mike. But anyway, it's how you get milk out of cows and milk from grass. They're not very clear, these pictures with the light here, folks, but not cutting a hellish volume there. The man in the machine hates that because he has to spend a long time before he gets a load. I love it because I get far milk, more milk out of cows with short grass than what I do with stuff that's about a foot tall. Because then that's probably beyond too much stem. But is it a fashion or is it a fad? There's another in there, that's cutting a tartan mixture, Andrew, and a machine designed for the job, the mower, bringing it straight up into here, not destroying the structure of the grass, it's basically just mowed once and then fed in there, and a cross conveyor out into the passage. And there you go, there you see it. That was a trial we did on behalf of dairy, or HB Dairy. 15 cows there, and that was to keep them going from 8 o'clock in the morning, that was as it was fed, and at 6 o'clock at night we put TMR in front of them because that was all gone. So 15 cows had scoffed. Roughly there was about nearly a ton and a half of grass there. Enormous amount of grass, and how these cows can eat that grass. Group feeding, and again not a very clear picture, but that's where I was feeding a group of 100 cows, and I just utilised the machine. And I would go out and cut another field. I would cut roughly around about 4 ton fresh grass every day. Some days in a dry day, two or three continual dry days, the full load would only be about 3 ton 800. On a really wet day, it was about 4.5 ton, reflecting on the dry matter. But these cows were being housed all the time. And really, what really the 100 cows, the best way of describing that, folks, is that that displaced 30 cows worth of TMR. Out of the diet. So I was trying to cut down my costs and looking at that there. That was only one feed. Going forward this year, I'm about to look at another machine and can we push that more and get more grass into these cows and give them the last feed of TMR and then feed more grass in the shed rather than putting the cows out. Is it a fashion or a fad? There's more and more dairy cows housed all the year round. It's easy to manage them in the shed. Fit them out the fields, unless you're really enthusiastic grassland manager, then you need to know what you're doing. So you keep them in the shed and feed them the same ration, it's easier done that way, it's contributing for everybody. But it's not for boys to play, it's cutting and carrying, it's the same as pasture management, the measuring grass, you need to know what you're doing from start to finish. You need to be measuring your grass, you need to know how much is in front of you, you need to know how much is coming behind you. And you need to make decisions on a daily basis when you come out of fields and go into the next field and such like. I prevent grass mixtures from whom? I don't know who would sell you grass like. But anyway, that's something I think, if this is beginning to become the norm, a lot of work coming from from the Emerald Island on cut and carry, or the machines coming out of there, Mary. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but some of you boys in general, I know that too. The one I showed there was an Italian machine, but there's more and more thought process on this, but I think there's ways and means we should be looking at, not just grass, but a grass mixture that can give us a more balanced diet, rather than just sticking to a perennial, right? We should be looking at the mixtures. I think there's scope for opportunity there, folks. Grass for milk and gut, not for field tidying. You get a 25-acre field when you get the right height, but that height there, they come at the end of the week and with that, then you need to make the decision to come out and lay that bit and cut it for size or bag it or bale it, whatever you want to do it. But don't just continue because all you see is your milk ticket top and drop it. And so it's again, it's back to how you manage grass. That's no different for you whether your cows are out in the field or in the shed. You need to measure that growth in front and behind, so it doesn't happen by magic. The advantage, you get total utilisation of the grass, you get no reject areas. And my other experience in the last 2 years of doing cut and carry is that you don't need the same area of ground as you would for going out to graze, because you're utilising the grass far better, so you can get away with a smaller grass platform better. But a positive mindset is required. Like everyone in this industry, you need to be enthusiastic, and you need to, it doesn't happen by magic, you need to be there, you need to be able to manage it and make it work. It's a daily task. Yes, you've gone out every day, rain, hail, or shine, once, twice, and even three times a day, whatever way you want to take it, right, folks. That's how cut and carry will only survive, I would say. It might just be another fashion. Some of us are old enough to remember the early years of zero grazing with old flail machines, and all. It was a great idea, and then folk got fed up and left and died back in the nettles during a bit, and forgot about it. Who knows? But farming is running circles. But you still need to look to get the right, to get the required amount of dry matter intake into your large dairy cow. You need to balance that with TMR. There's no way you will physically take on board enough grass, whether it's cut and carried or not, for a large Holstein Friesian cow to maximise it and express a full potential from grass alone. So we're going to need to look at balancing it somewhere along the line. Group management now, where to tell you manage your cows in the shed. As I said, I tell you that there. I saved roughly my work equipment at £130 a day just for putting in taking away 30 cows worth. Can I push it further? Yes, there's others do. Man, very more efficient than me at doing it. Been doing 500 cows along the southwest corridor of Newton Stewart. Coupon, he's been doing this and feeding 500 cows. I think there's merits in this, but again, it's not for everybody. But grass, as we said earlier, really made it quite loud and clear. Grass is our cheapest feed. It has to be managed. And that's right the onset today, folks, with all about management, I think. Follow that ride on with the slurry injector. Yes, I'm not a great believer in the blue bag, or whatever colour of bag, but if I was cutting carry grass, then there's no reason why we can't be going in with medical growth, separated liquid in the injector. And then within 21 days, you'll be back in again, so you can grow your grass all from your own nutrients and apart from operating and depreciation costs, could reduce your cost of production. It's an idea, I don't know where it fits in everybody in the room, but there's a gathering interest at the moment in this subject. You could also feed other young stock. We keep our young barn heifers in the shed, feed them big bale size, but push the hen on, we feed them fresh grass. There's other ways we could look at utilising, optimising there, and getting and managing the animals to the full potential. Land at stock cannot access, again, yes, if you've got roadways and whatever else looking about, you can't get cows out, then you can start to bring grass in. And does it fit in the automated systems? There's another question you need an answer, which is robotic milking for. Cow Health Project, started at Crichton in September, we're looking at dressing our cows up with a load of jewellery, but more importantly, they're milked through an automated milking system, but it's looking at the early detection of any of the health issues associated with the early lactation dairy cow, and the robot is part of that, but also all the other gizmos that the cows are wearing, and it's all being picked up electronically, and that could be subacute ruminacidosis, it could be mastitis, it could be lameness, it could be a whole range of different things there. So that's what this project, it's an innovative project put together by our various partners. An interesting subject, for me, I've never been involved in robots, but I'm still in the acre head in a 37-year-old shed, and it has worked fantastically well. I think robotics, and it's the early days for me, but my own personal opinion is, it could be the saviour for some in the dairy end industry, where you put a couple of robots in and you can look after 120 cows, you can feed your cows in the morning, you can go and do a job off farm, you can work at night, the European model, and you can still there and still manage to keep your farm business going. But it's for everybody's up, that's their choice, but I think there are some merits in where the robotics is going to fit in. I thought it would be a difficult transition for us at Crichton to go into robotics. I can assure you it's not been a difficult transition, but you need a positive mindset, as I say there. But from September to now, fantastic acceptance by the cows, which is important. You need the cows getting to take to the robot, but more importantly, I need the staff to embrace it too. The 47 cows averaging 35.1 kilos a day at the moment, with 19 heifers amongst them. The fresh ones, being less than 120 days, are averaging nearly 40 litres or 40 kilos. 15 of them, an average milking per day of 3.5 milkings to the robot in that time. We're feeding in the trough for maintenance plus 17, fairly basic ration, and our concentrate usage of it that day. Cut and carry could fit in with this facility ideally, so you can see what I'm thinking of going. Outwinter heifers, why would you outwinter? There's some thoughts about outwintering today. Robert's doing outwinter in the borders of drier country. Why outwinter at Crichton? Well, in 2014 I tried 30 spring calving heifers on a brassica big bale system. I think it was Swift and Red Star. He's maybe left the room now, but Ian from Germinal providing the seed. And just to try it, put it right next to the main road, and I was expecting a hell of a flap from the Joe Public, how these animals are out in all weathers. Anybody ever questioned it? The animals did fine. And basically we went from late November through to the end of March. And then we went through that field in mid-April with a set of discs twice, levelled it, put in a mixture of grass and fantastic fecal in that there. So it worked really well for spring calving black and white heifers. In 2015 we did a trial for the HDV. With 18 spring calving heifers and brassica big bale, with 18 on deferred grass for big bale silage, and with 18 housed in the shed. That was the three different scenarios. All rations were to achieve 0.8. We actually weighed the stock outside fortnightly to achieve that they were getting a 0.8 a kilogram a day daily live weight gain. And that was from mid-November to mid-March. First 14 weeks of the lactation, the animals were monitored. And I think the next slide tells you how they did. 2016 had 38 heifers out from the end of November to the 10th of January in a very, very wet December. No apparent effects on those animals, apart from myself and my staff having to go and shift the fence in the pea and rain. It's a bit of a challenge that you need to have the right mindset. Outwinter, and that was the study, folks. Our first lactation performance during the first 14 weeks of lactation. This is the HDV work, which had been outwintered in care with the K. So you can see the K ones at 27.9. You can see the differences there a wee bit there, right? So no great differences there at all. So beggars the question, we need an expensive shed for that type of spring calving animal or whatever. But again, it's postcode situated. You need to be in reasonable territory to do it, and dry, fairly dry feed drainage soil. But outwinter, and that's a photograph, and not a great take last year actually of the kale. But there's this bloody pup, it was with me again, it was there chasing heifers that you can see recently on kale. And last year, December 15, highest recorded ever at Crichton, 340 millimetres. And that gully down there, and days of water were running down through there. I won't tell you that it was running, but that's another story. But it would have been running there irrespective whether it was the cattle were there or not. Folks, I get involved about the RET. What is RET? The Royal Highland Education Trust. Some of you are involved with that. Fantastic organisation. About education of the countryside to schools, young people. The mission is taking the classroom to the countryside. About telling them where their food comes from. I think there's a huge gap there at the moment with urban and where actually foods. It's not the Tesco's and the Asda's this world. Forget what we do. So we have a responsibility ourselves, and I'm heavily involved in that. And I'm quite keen these days to try and encourage careers in the countryside back into the industry and try and get them interested into this fascinating industry called agriculture. Maybe not the most lucrative at presently, unless you're working for Watson's, maybe that might be different. But anyway, folks, it's all about engaging with your future consumers. I get a little kick out of that there, and the young people that come about the time. And that's the inside one of our K Carbig loos. As I said earlier, there's a carb training day on expecting the day. And we've got 8 of these igloos in a sort of, the cows choose where they go into these igloos. And that was the same group there. It was a food, higher food technology group. And one of these trailers, a mobile classroom. And in fact, again, thanks to Robert Nisbet, I came to Robert, I came to your far away back with the East Grassland Society, and you gave me the access trailers, and I said, I'm going to have one. I'm not sure who paid for yours, but I've got a grant to pay for yours too. But I followed your logic, boy, so I'm learning for you, like. Anyway, maybe mine's got 3 wheels on either side, it's maybe even bigger than yours, like, but we're not going to emphasize it. But anyway, fantastic, and a great way of showing the young people and other farming audiences around Crichton. You've got them covered. But folks, if I've interested in what goes on at Crichton, you're all welcome. Scotgrass is being held on the 18th of May this year. I'm not going to cancel it. Grass is looking well at the moment. That was 2010. We achieved an audience there between 7,000 and 8,000 folks that day. I'd like to think we'll get the same again, but who knows. But it's the 18th of May, folks, so you're more than welcome to attend, and you'll see some of the work I've talked about, because it'll all be available on that particular day. But I'm nearly finished, Johnny. Take home messages, folks. It's not what you hate, it's what you do with what you hate. I'd like you to work that out while I have another sip of this, Jim. You'll surely care what I mean by that. And those of you, Mary's now gone, but I'm going to say for the ones from foreign lands, when I do speak in England, I hate to tell them to make the most of what you have. Anyway, get it up for a challenge. You've got to try new ideas, folks. That's been my ethos over the years at Crichton. And I think it doesn't matter what you're doing in this industry, it doesn't stand still. We've learned that this morning, and I've given you some flavour of what's going on at Crichton. Shit does work. Pardon my language here, ladies, but you two need to do work. You've got to make it work. It's there anyway. It's not a waste. It's an asset. Attention to detail, like anything you do in life, folks. I know you put in, the more you're good at it. If you only take a half-hearted approach to it, then how many? The more you put in, the more you'll get back out of it, like. And that's where I get my enthusiasm, enjoy what I do, and try to get it 110% every day. I think that's where the ones that succeed in this industry. But anyway, about grass, you've got to source the best seed for the task. I'm not sure where you'll get that. I think the Germinal team have left, right? But never mind. But we've talked a bit today about managing your soil to get the best results. Don't always blame the seed supplier. And I think, Johnny, you'll have had that on numerous occasions. That bag of seed or that goes there is your fault. And it's maybe not always. We do have to take some of the blame and some of the responsibility when we do that. Like, so I showed you the tools up there. We've had it well demonstrated earlier today. We need to look after our soils and manage our farm better to get a better result. If you don't measure it, you cannot manage it. So again, I think that's loud and clear in every previous presentation today. Folks, again, something else, I'm a wee plug for my fellow colleague. He used to be Dr. Dave, he's now Professor Dave Roberts. He's doing a lecture next Tuesday, the 23rd, at Crichton, followed by a soils lecture, and I can't remember the name of the gentleman who's speaking from the James Hutton Institute, but it's in Easterfield Group Hall at 5 o'clock next Tuesday. So something again on the same theme of dairy and soils. Again, just to kind of let you know what's happening down in the southwest. Folks, this is my last slide, the proudest moment of my career. This was when I was in London in 2013, and I picked up this title of the Dairy Farm of the Year. The lady there, not showing a lot of cleavage and not a lot of plays on, but never mind, that's Jane King, she was editor of Farmers Weekly. The gentleman who happened to have left is Tim Bennett, he was head of Dairy Co. It's me in the kilt, you didn't recognise me. But more important is the lassie here, she was the hostess for the night. She was Kate Silverton, she worked for the BBC. She used to read the news. I met her that night before we went into the Great Hall, and she asked me where I came from, and I thought, Christ, I said, you know, Ken, the dress where I come from, I was in the kilt, like I come from north of the border. I said, who are you? Oh, I'm Kate. But at that point, she didn't have her glasses on, she had her contacts in, so I didn't recognise her. I said, put your bag down there and come here and give you a kiss and a cuddle. So I did, I gave her a kiss and a cuddle. And I thought I felt great, but never mind. Anyway, as the night progressed, she shouted me back up onto the stage and I got another kiss and a cuddle for her. But anyway, lo and behold, a month after that, she announced she was pregnant. Johnny, Johnny, I think I can wholeheartedly say I've not kissed any of the females today in the room yet. Like, you know, I'm available if they want. Like, we're not going to follow folks like that. That was a fantastic. If you ever get the chance, folks, to get to see what agriculture in the UK can deliver, fantastic night, fantastic cooperation. Robert, you've obviously been, you know what I'm talking about there. I think it's great. It epitomises what agriculture is all about. And to be honest, we had a great contingent of Scots doing last year. Bring on the Scots for sure. So folks, thank you for listening. That's me in the parlour. As you see, I wasn't milking that day, and I'm not milking again today. Eh? Johnny, I'm concluding my talk.
Thank you very much.